Good evening to everyone. I'd like to thank being here with you and tonight, in special, to speak about a topic that it's the gratitude, that it's touching all of us at different moments in our lives and different intensities. But all of us have lived through that and we'll live through that, different experiences in gratitude. What we propose today is that we're going to talk about two different perspectives. The Spiritist doctrine, and that comes from the Spirit and the Gospel. Allan Kardec doesn't talk about gratitude. He talks about ingratitude. So we're going to use those references about ingratitude, and then we're going to enter into the concept of gratitude brought by Joanna de Angelis and the book Psychology of Gratitude. That is her the last book of the collection of books that she wrote, bringing together the concepts of Spiritism and the concepts of analytical psychology. So you please feel free to ask any questions during this talk. Our commitment is not to go through all the slides, but to make you understand what we're going through. We prefer to stay only in the intro, but everybody's comfortable and understand what's going on. As I told you before, we're going to work with two books, and there are few questions and topics about three questions and topics about ingratitude in the Book of the Spirits. And we keep we have the feeling that there are a few questions, not because the topic is not interesting or is not part of our lives, but also a few questions because it's very easy to understand the question of ingratitude. And the Cosmic Origin to Spirits, we're going to find two texts. But the one that is more touching is about the gratitude of the kids towards their parents. That we say we have to honor your father and your mother. And after that, we're going to reflect on Joanna de Angelis. But to start, we're going to start with the question 937 of the Book of the Spirit. Allan Kardec asks, to the omen of the heart, deception. Okay. Are the disappointments caused by gratitude and by the fragility of the ties of friendship also a source of bitterness for the human heart? Sorry, please. Go ahead. When I look at this question, I keep thinking, it gives us an impression that Allan Kardec wants to justify why going through deception or ingratitude justify that we're going to be bitter or have difficulty to deal with the issues of our lives. It looks like he wants the spirits to say, okay, you're right, I justify being bitter. It's not the response that comes from them. If you want to justify the bitterness of your lives, the pitfalls of your lives, by the pains that your life and the sufferings that the life presented to you, you can do that, but you have to
pity
the people that were unfaithful and great to you. Gratitude is the daughter of selfishness, and selfishness we're going to find later other insensible hearts as yours has been insensible to. Talking about the process of pitying and saying self-pity, saying, oh, I've done everything to my kids and now they're turning their backs on me. Or in a relationship when you invested so much time in love and emotional sense, a marriage, the work, and then we start, you know, self-impeding ourselves because people gave up their backs on us and now we live in we are living through a certain suffering and pain. But we should not be feeling sorry for ourselves, not be blaming, because we are part of you know, of this problem, about this issue. But it may look like something that is not a problem. So let's seem like, oh, okay, that's his problem. He's going to suffer. It's not something like revenge. Oh, you did it to me. But there in the future, you're going to receive everything that you did that was not good. All the bad things you do are going to turn against you in the future. That's not something that the spirits are saying. You have to remember everyone who has done much more good than you have, that had much more value than you, and that they also had as a payment the ingratitude. Remember of Jesus. Jesus was despised and was undervalued by everyone and treated as even treated as scum when he was ascended.
In the beginning,
it looks like we have done everything to other people, that I am a wonderful person, how wonderful I am. And we call everyone that do not recognize how wonderful we are as people who are ungrateful. But it's saying here something different. It's saying, well, maybe you are not so wonderful as you think you are when you're putting yourself. He's saying, this is a hot place for you to be. You're putting yourself in a place of importance, that this person was so good to others. But sometimes this good that we think that we have given to others, that if you make a comparison, that Jesus has done so much good to everyone, he has suffered all the kind of ingratitudes that are much bigger than the ones that we suffer. So why are you complaining so much? You're becoming a little bit bitter, don't you? And I thought I was the best father, and my son was so ungrateful. But I got to think now that probably I was not the best father on earth. And then we close the Book of Spirits and say, well, we cannot understand very well this question, because it's hard to read Kardec. Have you ever heard about this? Is it hard to understand this answer, or it's hard to digest this answer? You're nodding. You need to nod to know because I need to know if you're understanding that, or you thought it would be something very easy, this talk. It's not. It's easy to understand, but it's hard to apply in our lives, because we prefer to put ourselves as a victim, the place of a victim, as someone who suffers. Oh, how good we are, and everybody else are so bad, and we are so good. And the Book of Spirits, the whole doctrine, Spiritist doctrine, is not gonna address our needs, that our need of putting ourselves as victims. And unfortunately, it makes that some people would not like to learn more about the doctrine, because this is not a proposal of, okay, poor boy, and really, you are right. But it's a different proposal. It's a proposal to think about your life and to understand what we did wrong and what we need to improve. Can we go to the next question? It gets even worse. Every question is, you know, it's getting worse. You're going to see that it's going to get worse in every question we go through. And then we need to go through. Do we go? So go on? Okay. So he got a kind of a slap on his face with this question. He didn't get what he wanted. And then Kardec asked another question. Couldn't the disappointment caused by ingratitude harden the heart and make it insensitive? We have suffered all this ingratitude, and it's not because of that that we're going to become hard and insensible. That's why, because we're in the process that we're going to start moving less and less with people around us. What do you think the spirits are going to answer for that? That would be unfortunate because persons with heart, as you say, will always be happy for the good they have done. They know that if the good they have done is not remembered in the present life, it will be in another, and that ingrates will then feel shame and remorse. I like this text very much for many reasons. But first of all, because it helped us to think that we were, if we had been hardening our hearts and becoming insensible, is because we haven't really made a good for someone. We want something in exchange, because I gave something and expect something in return. And when you don't return that to me, I get angry at you. So it doesn't mean that we did something good to you, but we try to trade something, a bargain. Because someone who gives in the sense of doing the good, this person will always feel good because of the good he has done. Maybe we find out that we do almost nothing that is really good. Because we are always expecting of being recognized. Joana de Angelis makes an analysis of one of the family therapy 10, 15 years from now. There was a term that was very well known in the family. Yes. The family therapy, that it's the emptiness, syndrome of emptiness. I'm depressed because my emptiness, because my kids, you know, got out of our home, went to college or something. And that what's called emptiness, that the mother gets depressed, is nothing more than selfishness of that mother that gave. And at the time that the kids are going to take advantage of everything she gave, she's going to turn back against that son or somebody who gave so much. That's the same thing when your son is trying to get a wife. Because every time your son is going to get a wife, he's going to say, "Well, I don't like her very much. She's not the right one for my son." And she's going to do the same thing all the time. It's because she thinks about being the perfect woman for her son, because she gave everything to him. And some fathers are thinking that the kids have always to look at their parents because they give everything to them, but it's not the case, you know. When I give, and after that I have an aftertaste that is bitter, is that I did not the good, I did an exchange, a bargain for something that I wanted to feel good after doing the good to someone. And when we are self-observant, it's that we make a mistake on what Jesus is saying, that sometimes we're not receiving on the earth, but we are going to receive an afterlife. And when he says, the last will be the first, we even like to suffer a little bit on earth, because it means that when we go, when disincarnate, that is going to be wonderful. No, it's not going to be wonderful. Even when after we disincarnate, a certain point that the spirits, they love to suffer. Have you ever heard about it? The spirits love to suffer because we create a fantasy that if we suffer a lot here in the afterlife, it's going to be wonderful. Maybe it's going to be as bad or even worse than what's going on here, because God doesn't like this kind of relationship that you're giving something in the expectation of receiving something in return. Kardec was not so, you know, happy with this response from the spirits. If he was not a noble, I was saying that he is a bitter person trying to really justify his feelings. But he makes the third question, insisting on it. But this knowledge would not prevent their heart from feeling hurt. mightn't this lead them to think they would be happier if they were less sensitive? So there will be, you're going to go through many pains, and this is going to, you know, hurt your heart. Wouldn't that be better? That we would be less sensible, get less involved with people, love less in a relationship, give less to the kids. Doesn't it seem more logical? Because what I've most learned in my marriage is that we don't have to bow our heads. Have you ever heard about it? What do you think? Wouldn't we be more happier if you were less sensitive? Look what they say. May, if you prefer the happiness of a selfish. This is a very sad happiness. Nobody hurts you because you don't get involved with anyone. You don't suffer. But you never have the pleasure or the happiness or the real happiness. Those three questions, they help us to think about other things about ingratitude, other aspects of ingratitude. The first one, when I say that someone was ungrateful to me, I'm saying that I did something good and the person did not recognize the good I've done to them, to her or to him. And then we are obliged to think about Jesus with the question, we place in check if the concept of the person was ungrateful. But have I offered really the good? Have I really cared about my kids? It was really a good? Or did I use my kids to promote myself in the society? What else with the education of the kids? They are more worried about not going to school meetings or if the school, you know, they want like to have kids to go to their sleepover and their friends, and they want to hear like, oh, your kids are so polite, so well-educated. Or in a relationship, I say that I love someone just for the person to say back to me that this person loved me and take care of me. For me to say that somebody wasn't grateful, I would have to be sure that the things I've done was a really good thing. But that's something that we cannot be sure. But the second question, he says that maybe he has forgotten in this life, but will be remembered in another life. If I'm sure that I've done something good to someone, I still cannot make sure that this person is still being ungrateful. It may be that now this person is not recognizing the good that you have done, but probably in the future this person is going to recognize. The problem is not that your neighbor. The problem is what I want now, that I want to do things now and I want to see the results now. Because sometimes the person needs a little bit more time to digest all those questions. And not necessarily this person is being ungrateful. Let's see an example of Peter in our initial that phenomenon that we
Peter's denial.
Peter has denied Jesus, and Jesus could say that he was ungrateful. But up to that moment, he had not understood the size of the issue. And after he lives that painful experience of denying Jesus, is that he comes to himself, then he understands what happened, and he makes himself one of the most important pillars of the church. But the way that we want to do everything so quick, We want to be so immediate that we want all the answers so quickly. We want the answer now. And there are so many parents there. They put themselves into so many troubles because they, when they see their parent, the kids going through addiction or suicidal actions, and
wanting them to change their behavior.
And they want them to change their behavior. But what you're doing now today to your kids, there are going to be repercussions in another life. But I am want everything right now, I want everything to happen just after I've done something good. What do you think about it? And to make it worse, look into our third situation here. We start understanding that we are immediatist. That we are very proud and because everything I do is so important and everyone should recognize that. And because, you know, people are not recognizing me, they are just below me. We're the pedestal that we are, you know, giving alms to everyone. And when the people do not applaud us, I would not offer those alms or crumbles anymore to anybody else. In the middle of this rational, we can think that there is only one situation that is, and that we can say this was ingratitude. There is just one situation that I can say this was an act of ingratitude. What is this situation? Maybe I haven't done good enough. Maybe the person has not recognized it yet. It can be that this person is not going to retribute the way I thought it could be real. In none of the situations, I would say the person was ungrateful to me. But there is one situation that it was ingratitude, the real one. There is one situation only that I can say there is real ingratitude. Somebody said suicide. No, suicide, no. Because it can be the person has committed suicide now. But that the person has learned is going to repercute in another, going to refashion in another lifetime. It can be only a matter of time. In which situation I can affirm that it was ingratitude? Have you really followed my rationale here? To be sure that I did really the real good to somebody else, and maybe that person is digesting that it's going to be a repercussion later. Maybe the person recognized that, but the person doesn't give the recognition as I wanted, like the mom that wanted during the prom, the son would say, this is my best, the prom speech, the son would say, my mom is the best of the world, but there is just one situation where this can happen. There is one, she's saying that the ingratitude would be questionable, and that would be sure that person is there is ingratitude. But you know, after that, we cannot be sure. It can be the person is still digesting that, the person is recognizing that, but the person didn't tell me that it was that. But sometimes the person recognizes you, but haven't told you how grateful he is. But there is only one situation that I can say it was ingratitude. But the idea is just that. As we start to make things relative. This is other no, because can you repeat?
Repete a pergunta dele.
he said, because kids ingratitude towards the parents. But today I can classify my son as ingrate. But with time, this kid may reflect, have some reflection and understanding, and you know, with time, he or she can recognize that I did so much good for him. The only situation that I can really affirm that it was an ingratitude is my own ingratitude. Because I know that the good that I have received it, and I know when I wasn't grateful for the good I have received it. So I never would affirm that somebody is ungrateful towards me. But I can only affirm that there is ingratitude when I was not able to be grateful toward other people or my neighbor, somebody who has been so good to me. That's a bad thing, isn't it?
Even the cheating husband.
Even the cheating husband and the suicidal person that left a letter accusing the fathers, the parents cannot be accused of ingratitude.
Hey, Pedro, por favor.
There is an expectation in relationship to the other. Expectation based on my own fantasies that what I've done was something good, because for them it could not be good. I think it's something good, but for them it might not be. What I've done has to reflect right now, and when it doesn't, I think that the person is being ungrateful, or the person didn't recognize it in the manner that I was expecting them. Because people in their prayers, don't they say, Lord, thank you so much that Marlon has done for me. But they don't mention it to me, but maybe he is grateful. So in no relationship with others, we can actually affirm that that happens. Only when me, myself, thinks, I never thanked my parents for what they've done to me. Well, then I'm sure that I was being ungrateful. Or I thanked my parents, but it wasn't enough compared to what they offered me. So then really I am ungrateful. I was never grateful to the country that welcomed me. And I was never grateful to my husband that even before all these sorrows and those disenchantments was still a very important person in my life. I never thanked my children because after I had them, my life was never the same again. I was always expecting for them to thank me. When I think that I was the biggest beneficiary of this relationship, only when looking towards ourselves that we can be certain that it was an ingratitude. Were you expecting this? I can see that you guys kind of withered. Relationship to suicide, can the suicide think about that, but not us thinking about him? There are many suicides that are going to justify saying that the world was ungrateful, that the parents were ungrateful, that the children were ungrateful towards them, or that the spouse, you can't affirm that. But if he looks at himself or herself, for sure, he's going to find situations where he was ungrateful himself because he was closed off to the world. It's a good thing you bring this up, because it makes us think that there are many people that want to justify the mistaken act of suicide as a justification of other people's ingratitude. It's not true. Tough, right? Can't even justify that you did worse, that you don't believe in love, that you become hardened because people are ungrateful. No. This only reveals that you are a person that demands instant results, that you only are recognized in your own way, in your own time, and you demand applause. Because it could be that people are grateful to you, but in their own thoughts, but you want fireworks, and you didn't have fireworks of gratitude. You go, oh, how ungrateful. Nevermore will I help them again. Never again. Relationship of bargain. You really didn't help. You were doing an investment. You know, an investor gets a stock equity and invest in order to get a return, that's investment. So you're going to discover that you shouldn't really do investments in other people expecting a return, because the investment must be in ourselves. But don't call it an investment in other people to get a return. Don't call that as goodness or as good, that you did something for something else. It's a just an interesting action that has an interest inherent. So when you already think in gratitude, you are already being ungrateful. Let me repeat for the translators. She says, so does that mean that when you think about ingratitude, it already means that you didn't do good, real good? Yes. It already means that you were expecting a return. And if you were expecting a return, then you really didn't do the good, because good lives for the simple pleasure and the satisfaction of doing the good, for the good itself, unconditionally. There's two sides of the coin, my side and... If I think you were ungrateful towards me, perhaps I wasn't so good to you. But there's the other side, which there was another attitude. In a situation.
The way you were saying,
that it's not an investment, like a bargain. I'm generous towards you because I was generous to you. But do you believe? I was generous because I am generous? You believe that that's it? I'm trying to understand what she said. If I think that you were ungrateful towards me, it's because I wasn't so good to you, period. That I understood. But there's another side which perhaps there was a behavior that wasn't very worthy. So he or she will judge their behavior to himself. The only person that can tell that there was some kind of ingratitude is the person that did the action only. Each person in relationship with themselves. Because I could think that I was good towards someone else, but maybe they don't understand that action as being good, or I could have done the good and he could perceive it as something good, but he's still maturing those reflections and may change only later. Or he could be grateful, but not really tell me, because people don't need to tell little thank you letters to everybody for what we do. So I can never affirm that the person was ungrateful, but I have the ability to recognize only when I was ungrateful or not. And it's to look within oneself the whole time. Because every time I'm saying to them that somebody else was ungrateful, lost your reference point. You lost the condition of analysis, because I can never do this kind of inference in somebody else's behavior. There's no way. There's no way how to. And looking at this, we can see that you cannot affirm that.
You think it's possible
for us in this lifetime to act in this manner and to do this unconditionally without this interest? Because I said that, because it doesn't mean that I act like that. This is just a question I have. I think a lot of people that I know ask the same questions or do these same things, not out of wickedness. Do you think to reach that level when we go to the other life or another realm of behavior, do you think, are we able to act in this way now? Because I think of many people who act like this unconditionally. Perhaps the parents can do so. They have some moments like that. So it's 30 questions I asked. Oh, 30 people. I can think of 30 people, but maybe only one or two people who have that profile. And we won't even know if those people were doing it with this interest. Because it could be that I am very good here with you guys, give of myself, give my body, give my life to the spirit center in a huge assistance work, but deep inside, in my unconscious, I want God to recognize me. So not even of those 30 people, or the two people out of your 30 in your example, will be sure that they were being disinterested. One thing is clear, we are in the world of trials and expiations. What does that mean? In these worlds, evil predominates over good, prevails over good. So it's a fantasy for us to think that good is going to take over in a creature that still dwells in the world of trials and expiations, with the exception of missionary spirits. This predominance of looking at someone and living for the other is characteristics of worlds that are more advanced. Even when we have a surrendering and a giving of towards our children, even then it's still my child, not somebody else's child. So can you notice how much selfishness there's still there? Still my children, it's my friends. But the other person's sons, whose I know, they can die for all I care. If my son is in the war, I'm going to mobilize the whole world so that he can come back home. But once he's back, we're good. So still, it's very ego-driven. It's still our ability to give is directly related to the return for our personal benefits. And I don't believe this is a problem. I just need to have the conscience, the awareness, that when I do things knowing that I am not this good and wonderful person that's giving to somebody, I'm not going to accuse them of being ungrateful. Because I understand this is a relationships and people are being benefited because I'm also benefiting myself when I'm with them. And when I'm sure that I have no benefits, then I go back to those relationships. That's human being. We're only going to accuse somebody of being ungrateful, and it's only going to hurt when we think that we are very wonderful and they didn't recognize how wonderful we were. But in the end, to recognize that the level we're in is easier to handle things in life. It's a little more raw, the reality. Can you imagine a mother who had children thinking, I really don't want kids, I hate children, but because I read in the books that are many spirits wanting to reincarnate, I'm going to have one, like 4 or 5 of them, in order to help move the line. Can we imagine such a situation? No. Because the child that I have is the realization of my dream, the fulfillment of my dream. It's my kid. Can you imagine somebody who's going to get married? They look at the homeless person on the street and say, oh dear, didn't have the opportunity. I'm going to marry him so I can give him new possibilities to this man so he can have a new path in life. Would you marry for that reason? No. We get married with the man that's going to make me happy. And when he doesn't make me happy, I'm going to find the benefits that I can extract from the money, from the status or whatever. But when it no longer works out or there's no benefits, we get out of it. Or we stay in the relationship because I read in the book by Andrea Luiz that woman was disgraced who stayed with her husband who died and went to the spirit realm, a really, really beautiful place in the spirit realm. So I'm going to stay with her because I'm going to use this man as my springboard to step on him and reach a high level of the spirit world. So you see, the whole time, openly declared his personal interest. Acting out of personal interest.
How to deal
we need to apply this, how to deal with the incessant I can't hear incessant demands of people. Hey Patch, how to deal with the incessant demands of people that we be grateful for what they've done for us. A constant nagging. Well, why are you concerned about that? you care, you're going to be judged. But it's of course that the person cut you off. It's good, you're going to maintain this type of relationship. If you cut them off, thank you for cutting me off. I didn't have to break it myself. What are we going to do with these kind of people? Oh, if only there I don't pay them a compliment, they're going to be mad at me. But please, let them be mad. Why do I have to maintain such a relationship in this level? Perhaps everything has a price. Maybe we have relationships with much less people than we really do, but I think it's healthier. Because the few relationships that we may have, may they be profound and truthful ones, where I can be who I am, where I can express what I feel, and I can support the person who as they are, and I give them the space for them to express themselves who they are. This type of relationship, you don't need more than five of those in one lifetime. So you have two, you know, if one is traveling, three, you know, you can have three, it's perfect. But sometimes you have so many relationships that you can't find a single one at this level, not with spouse, children, because we're spending so much energy in maintaining an appearance of good people to the world outside. The people that deserve our investment in these type of relationships, we can't really have the time to do it. It's very sad. Can I do a comment? I understand that you're talking about the fact that we expect a lot of people and knowledge, and we give ourselves, and we don't receive anything in return. But doesn't this have anything to do with ego? I do something for you, and you don't thank me. You don't care. But I keep waiting for that return, and it doesn't come. So that's something that inside of me, it upsets me. But isn't that a process of healing that I need to work on myself? No, I agree 100%. My question is, the healing is not the healing because the person was ungrateful. I'm going to heal myself because of his ingratitude. I can't be sure that the person was ungrateful. So we're placing the question of being harmed or the judgment that I made that the other person was ungrateful. Not because he harmed me. Oh, he's really ignorant and we accept that people are as they are. What I'm challenging here is really, did he harm me? Was he really ungrateful to me? Did what I offer was truly good? Does he truly not recognize what I've offered? What we're questioning here is, do we really think in fact he hurt me, or is it just a fantasy that the ego created that he hurt me and the world needs to subscribe to my insanity? So how to work this question of the ego? If we place ourselves above where we should be, to think that we are better than we are, to think that we do more than we actually do, and that others should consider us more than we consider ourselves or others. It's a fantasy, not to say insanity. Translate in 1 second.
Resume para a gente traduzir.
To the difficult part is for us to look at our insignificance, because in the end we are insignificant in relationship to our children's education, we're insignificant to our changes in marriages, we're insignificant in relation to society. It's an insignificance that we can't really bear, because we want to be viewed as better, as more important. But think about child rearing or child education. We think we're so important. I'm a father of millions and millions and millions of fathers that this person has had in previous lives. He was the first in university. Okay, great. Because he had a brain that allowed the manifestation of that brilliant soul, which I didn't create. And sometimes we think we do the best for our children and they become delinquents or criminals, because that what which we offered is really insignificant. And when I recognize my insignificance, that's the trigger, or that's what I wanted to offer as a reflection, that when I recognize my insignificance, naturally, I am grateful. Because the biggest impediment for me to be grateful is to think that I deserve. And when I deserve, I don't need to thank. I pay for the servant, and he does it for me. He's getting paid for that. I don't need to thank. But when I recognize my insignificance and that I don't deserve that I think I deserve, but I gain them as a divine mercy and generosity, then I thank, I become grateful. The healing of ingratitude comes from gratitude. We're going to get there. One second. Yes. After, if we don't get there, you remind me and we'll go back to it. I'm going to skip a little bit because of the time, because we're going to talk the definition of gratitude. We're going to discuss this recognition, this acknowledgement of our insignificance or smallness, which makes us leave that pedestal that requires that people look at us, recognize us, or value us. We come down from that pedestal, and as we do, naturally, we are grateful. And within this logic, I wanted to bring this three levels of gratitude, which Joanna De Angelis establishes in the book, The Psychology of Gratitude. The greater our ability or capacity to recognize myself as small, the greater my level of gratitude. Did you follow? I'm going to skip. So the first level, I'm going to think of three levels. The first, to be grateful for the good that comes to me, or that comes to you. Be grateful for the good that comes to you. Can you think of something? That's something good that has happened in your life and that you should be grateful for? Tell me. Something that you think that I should be grateful for. To wake up in the morning, to be in life. To get cured from a disease.
To be able to serve my parents.
To be able to
serve my parents. Serve, take care of my parents.
To be able to take care of the parents. My bed, which I haven't slept in, because to not have a bed is terrible. The people that come into our life. What else? Health, that we cherish when we don't have work, which also when we don't have is when we truly miss it and remember to be grateful for it. Filtered water, faucets. My grandma used to say that there was no faucets in the time, and how she was to wash clothes and take showers. I used to say, oh my God, we open the faucet and the water comes out, and let it open. We don't even remember. And the moment we open our eyes in the morning, everything that happens, the air, the rain, everything can be a motive of gratitude or a reason for gratitude. But I want you to think so that your conscience can really weigh in this moment reasons for gratitude. Because you're thinking of reasons to be grateful for. Because if you haven't been grateful for so far for the things we've mentioned, then you're being ungrateful because I don't remember to be thankful every day. Thinking that I was able to open my eyes in the morning or to lie on my bed that allows me to rest or the people that come into my life. Because we enter into a logic that's so alienating and disconnect ourselves from the good feelings that are important for our mental health. When the sun doesn't rise, we miss it. But when the sun comes out from the clouds, we don't have a feeling of gratitude for it being there. Or sometimes for just a little time, because then it's too much sun, it's too hot. So we discover that there are countless reasons to be grateful for, and which we're not. Joana de Angelis says, how much does the pure air of nature, the clean air of nature, the beauty of the landscape, the healthy climate, how much does all that cost? When food comes to the table, how many people participated in the anonymity of this whole life-sustaining chain process? Anything that happens is linked to the dependence of one another, individual or circumstance, that provided this moment. How many accidents, disenchantments, illnesses, and deaths have marked existences that have surrendered to the discoveries, material and intellectual discoveries, to the transformations that were operated so that they would become happy communities, even out of which we pay for somebody that collects the garbage. Somebody didn't collect the garbage, what would it be of us? Somebody that takes the heavy work of construction, or who sows and harvests, cleans and packages things, and make good use of the food. How many people are involved
in everything
that we are connected? People that had the idea to organize a spirituality center and provide this space for us, these chairs, and organize themselves every day so that we can arrive here and take part in it and benefit from it. To think of the first spiritists when Kardec had to break from the prejudices of the time so that we could be here today, and the countless sleepless nights that he went through. Or to think of the first Christians who, even running the risk of life, gave their lives so that today we could name ourselves Christians. There's infinite reasons to be grateful all every day, in every moment, but not grateful out of a duty or obligation. The most interesting part of the psychology of gratitude is to discover that the greater my ability to be grateful, the greater my state of fulfillment is.
In our text in Lucas chapter 17, that said that Jesus was going to Jerusalem. I don't know in which city he was passing by, because my memory is not so good. But the essence of the story is this. Jesus was there, and then came 10 leprosy people with him, people with leprosy to him, asking for it to be healed. And he said, go to the priest and ask to be healed. In the middle of the way, all of 10 are cured, and just one of them comes back to Jesus to say thank you. And when he puts himself to the feet of Jesus and he said, wasn't 10 that were cured? Where are the other 9? And then I was thinking, if we are more, if we resemble to that one that came back to say thank you, or we are those other 9 that did not come back to thank Jesus, as if it was the obligation of Jesus to cure them. Can you make a relationship with the insignificance of us? If we think ourselves so good, we ask Jesus to be cured and he cures. But when I'm able to recognize my insignificance, that Jesus cured me, and I go there naturally, I thank him. Does it make sense for you? But the first level of gratitude is to be grateful for the goodness that comes to us. The second level of gratitude, it's, you know, I told you that's getting worse, but he wanted to insist on that. The second level of gratitude is to be grateful for the evil that is not coming to you. There are so many good things that would happen to us in the day of today, for example, because maybe somebody came to this spiritual center and, you know, because of an accident or a bad news or anything that was not, because of something that happened during the day, this person couldn't come to the spiritual center. But we were able to come because we were protected. Some of us will be able to come back home, some others will not. But when I come back home, I have to think about all the things that could have happened to me, bad things that could have happened to me and didn't happen. And I have to thank God because that those bad things have not happened to me. And when I come to my bed, I have to think of the bad things that have not happened to me. And we have to talk about, you know, to be thankful about the heater, because the day that the heater is not working or the heater would not work, it would be so difficult to be here. But I've been through an accident, but it could have been worse. We could have been hurt and hurt our legs. Oh, but it hurt my legs, but it would break my legs, but, you know, it would be even worse, but it would be amputation. But it wasn't amputated, but it is something every time it could be worse. So when we go for situations, we need to think that every time would be worse than it was. Urban violence. I was robbed. But you could be robbed and also spanked. But you could rob it, spank it, rape it. There is always a graduation that things could be even worse than it was. And because it was not worse than it was, I am thankful to God. Does it make sense for you? Once I was, you know, giving this lecture and somebody raised their hands, said, wow, but we have to think about everything all the time. And then he was even more annoyed because I said, that's it. You have to be thankful for everything all the time. And this is going to produce as a state of well-being. We're going to be expecting the things that did not. We're going to be thanking for the insatisfaction and the emptiness is not because the things are going to come, but the incapacity of recognizing what we have today. Do you agree with me? But when I have a better salary, but when I have this or that, we keep ourselves in the future that never comes. When we recognize the incapacity of being grateful for what we have today, it's not a major for life. Because major is to have lots of possibility and be below average. It's not this. the restriction of freedom a little bit. But I had never done anything wrong. But there are a lot of people who have been arrested and have done anything wrong. The illnesses. There are so many illnesses in the world. But it means that the medicine is advancing. There more diseases are appearing, and we are so exposed to so many illnesses. The war, hunger. But although there are so many people that are dying by the excess of food, starving to death is something, the spirit, it's something that we cannot even describe. I remember a young man in an institution of poor boys would say, "Isn't it blue?" He was addicted to that. He said, "Uncle, there are sometimes there is a, it's, you know, being starving is so hard. There is an emptiness inside of us that only smelling blue, sniffing blue, that was something that would fulfill our need for food that we cannot get there." Humanity, the lack of humanity toward others, kindness toward others, misery and poverty. You know, living below the poverty line, being deprived of education. It's easy when we're talking about in the spirit center, talking about, you know, studies and everything, when we have so many opportunities of being educated. Social privation, not having political liberty or political freedom. If we were incarnated in Islam, when we are, we don't have access to so many things, and we go through so many restrictions. Natural catastrophes. And always when I bring this picture, I remember of something that happened in the state of Santa Catarina. That something happened the same day, the two situations that happened, the contrary, opposite situations that happened the same day. The woman that was crying desperately because she has lost her house. The other woman that she was crying of happiness because she was with her kids. The same one, the two of them have been through the same situation, but one was crying because everything that she had lost. And the other one, she was crying of happiness for the things that she hadn't lost. Violence, especially domestic violence. Because having fathers, and the worse they were, we had parents. But domestic violence, when you leave the abuse of power, abuse of domestic violence, the only fact of not going through domestic violence is something that we have to be grateful, even if our parents were not as good as we thought they could be. Now it's ended, almost over, it's almost the end of our talk. Now we're going to the third level of gratitude. The second level is to be grateful for the evil that has not arrived to us. The third level of gratitude is being grateful for the bad things that come to us. Joana de Lanzi says, in a superficial vision or perspective, we would see that there is a pathology of a masochist pathology when we're thinking about the suffering. Do you know what is a masochist? Masochist is the person has the takes pleasure in feeling pleasure or suffering, and sadic is the one that likes to generate pain or inflict pain on another person. That's why we have the sadomaso relationships. It's not a, you know, It's not that it's a magic is perception when we say thank you God for, you know, robbing my car or having somebody in our family who passed it. It's not this. But on the contrary, it's to have a maturity that, you know, material of being grateful for the evil that comes to us, but it doesn't mean that it's, you know, your attachment to suffering, but it's an acceptance of the suffering and the acceptance of the good, bad things that come to us, the pitfalls and the issues that come to us in our life. I'm not going to look for some situations that are going to bring me pain, but I'm able to accept the pain and the suffering that life brings to us. Do you understand that? The oyster shell does not allow the pearl to be collected. For it to have real meaning, it breaks the vigorous crust and splendor the pale and remarkably built gem. I think it's beautiful, this analogy of the oyster, because if we were, you know, if you didn't want to break this shell, we would never see the beauty inside. We can compare the pains and difficulties of life as this movement of breaking the shell. Because of through those pains and problems that we're gonna break through this shell of the ego, that it's always putting yourself as the best, that everything has to be in our way, in our time, to diminish, to see what's a good thing in us, to flourish, to surface. And it's much better to use this analogy of the oyster, because the oyster will only produce a pearl when there is an invasion body inside. If it's trying to defend against that invasive body, it keeps excreting a substance that will start producing the pearl and making it a precious pearl. If there are no issues in the oyster's life, the oyster was not invaded by any kind of external body, we would never have this pearl. That's why.
Sometimes we're so shameless, we take care of our things only when it's missing, because when the exams come back normal, we go back to all the things we were doing in a behavior that's wrong. In reality, everything that happens that produces unpleasant sensations or uncomfortable emotions is part of the experiences that promote the human being. As long as the purpose is understood, expressing gratitude for its occurrence. Look how deep this sentence. Everything, in fact, that happens, even when it produces unpleasant sensations or uncomfortable emotions, is part of the experiences that promote the human being. So that which I complain, what I don't like, what I feel uncomfortable, I can look at it as an accident in my path, or as a problem, or I can recognize it as something that contributes to my evolution. I lose my job. I can think that it's my boss's blame who fired me. I can look at life as a perfect system that's perfectly organized, where that gets transformed into an instrument of promotion, teaching me things that I wouldn't have learned otherwise if life was comfortable. What do you think? I think that's the most beautiful part in Spiritism, because it makes us understand that in fact that we encounter an evolution. But one thing that I notice, for somebody who stands on the outside or who doesn't have a consistency, and when somebody's going through something very tough, and I have a tendency to thank that moment, to maintain this spirit. Who's standing from the outside thinks that I'm too much of an optimist. Then you're just thinking of the positive and things are not really this way. Or when you go through the experience, sometimes you can't really have this feeling of gratitude because you get so desperate. The majority of the time, Jonah usually says that we're going to feel gratitude when we understand the purpose. When we are going through the experience, we can't really feel that because we haven't really understood the purpose. But after it happens, we then see that it was good, that lost job that fired me stimulated me to reflect on certain postures, and I've become a more accessible person, which then opened a door to my life. I only be able to be grateful after I can examine this whole journey. But this question of everything that happens has as an objective the promotion of the human being, that's very comforting, isn't it? I can't perhaps recognize in the moment the motive or the reason for it, but it is comforting to know that the world does not move by random forces, but that there is an energy that maintains in a perfect functioning that's perfectly organized, that has our promotion and growth as the purpose. And I like this sentence even better. Gratitude for its apparent failures constitutes the recognition that they are part of learning, and its occurrence in the form of displeasures, moral sufferings that are a consequence of betrayal, slander, abandonment, that is relegated by former affections, have a reason for being. We are talking here, perhaps, of the biggest sorrows and pains that humans can go through: betrayal, slander, abandonment. And even these great moral pains have a reason for being. But for me to understand the reason for their being, I need to presuppose that I have something to learn from it. Because when I presuppose that there's something to learn from it, then I ask God, what are you trying to teach me with this? When I think that I need to be served, then I say, God should not have done this with me or to me. God should not have done this to me. Is me placing myself above God to say how life should be? Do you guys remember about insignificance when we were talking about? The greater our condition of understanding our own insignificance, the greater will be our gratitude towards life and for everything it has to offer, including the sorrows and pains that life presents us. Because since I know and recognize who am I, hardened, selfish, vain, proud person, I need to go through these experiences in order to learn. But when I think that I'm wonderful, a missionary that came to earth to save souls who are unhappy, then everything that comes to me as a stone in my path becomes an offense. And sometimes we say, who do you think you are? Which reveals who I think I am. The true gratitude derives from humility. true gratitude comes from humility. Joanna Jean, this is a noble soul, so it comes from a significance. She recognizes herself as insignificant. And in the end, it could relate this to the love thy enemies. Because to understand gratitude through this perspective helps us to understand the composition of this love thy enemy commandment. When somebody does harm to me, and I believe that I am a good person, then I create a fantasy that they harmed me. And if he did not exist, then this wouldn't have happened to me. When I understand through logic, thanks to the psychology of gratitude, how I have a need of learning something, or according to Joanna Jungelis, that they have, these things have a reason for being, then when something does harm to me, and I believe that that has a reason for being, this makes me conclude that if it weren't for him, somebody else would have done it. And if it wasn't somebody else would have done it. Because I have the need to experience this learning. And so I'm no longer stuck being angry at that person because I understand that he or she was solely an instrument for my learning. And if the need for me to learn didn't exist, then God wouldn't have allowed for that person to hurt me. Because then God would be unjust. And so we can understand the logic of loving our enemies, because those people that hurt us today, those people that abandoned or disrespected us, they end up becoming my instrument of learning. And so sometime from now, when I become a better person, because now I treat my spouse better because I did suffer a lot in my previous marriage, then I thank my previous spouse because I learned what a true relationship is like thanks to the suffering I endured. And I thank life for the pains and sorrows that they presented to me because I was able from those to become a better person. And I'm certain that everything that life offers me is in direct need of, in direct proportion to my need and my learning, because then otherwise God could not be considered just or good. If he was just good, then he would be a punishing God. He did it, get the consequence. He can't be just good, otherwise he would be permissive. Oh, poor you, you're not going to handle it. So God is just and good. He is going to offer the experiences to us in the measure of our needs of learning. So more than complain or to get mad, when pain comes to us, we begin to thank. Not like a silly person that throws words in the wind, but thank, because we understand that in even pain or suffering, in everyone, the generous invitation of God to review our postures and understand something that we were not able to learn ourselves up to now. And so we symbolically bow down to the floor saying, thank you, God, for the bad or the evil that came to me because it's stimulating me to become a better person. Let's take this moment to close our eyes, to breathe deeply. Põe música, alguém. To feel the presence, the air that's filling our airs of lungs. Relaxing deeply, eliminating any tension point or anxiety in our body. Notice your legs, notice your thighs, your butt muscles, your glutes, your column, your vertebrae. Melt yourselves onto the chair. Relax your shoulders, your arms, your hands. Relax your neck muscles, your jaws, your tongue, your facial muscles. Surrender yourself. Surrender yourself more and more. Come into contact with your breathing. Deeper breaths. And with every exhalation, relax. And take advantage of this moment to allow yourself to come to your mind. The pain, experience the painful experiences that life has brought you in the past. Or perhaps the painful experiences that life may bring you in the future. Many of us have lived through betrayals, rejections, disrespect, abandonment, incoherent postures from our parents, lack of consideration from our friends. Allow your soul to bring back from those deeper painful experiences that many times routine encourages us to forget because they're tough to be felt. Sometimes we can't even understand how deep that pain is because of the difficulty that we have in enduring it. But now, take advantage of this moment and let your soul tell you the painful experiences that still dwell in it so that from these experiences, you can ask yourself, what did you learn from them? In what did they help you in becoming a better person? Perhaps we may only learn to be loving by living with people who are tough. And then learn the importance of respect when we are disrespected. Sometimes we only learn to look into the eyes if we can consider somebody when we feel the pain of not being considered by others. So ask yourself, what has life taught you with those painful experiences? What does God want to teach you with these difficulties? And open your heart so that God can speak inside of you, inviting you to a change, inviting you to reflect on better days, more conscious days, more surrendering in comparison to those rebellious days when we didn't want to accept the presence of God inviting us to transform ourselves morally. And so let us remember the poet who wrote through the hands of Givaldo Franco, the text entitled Psychology of Gratitude, in order to conclude tonight's activity. Lord God, we are here, the ones who love you, rise up to thank you. We want to say that life is beautiful and that instead of asking you who I really have, I want to actually thank you today. And so, Lord, thank you for what you have given me, for what you give me. Thank you for the air, for the bread, for peace. Thank you for the beauty my eyes see on the altar of nature, eyes that look at the sky, the earth, and the sea. They accompany the light bird that runs through the indigo sky, and they lean on the green earth, dotted with flowers in thousand shades. Thank you so much, Lord, for my ability to see, because through my eyes I can contemplate nature and all the panels of beauty eyes that allow me to see love. But with my vision, I detect blind people walking in the darkness, who weep in solitude, who suffer in the crowd. For them I pray, and to you I implore pity, because I am sure that after this life, in the other life, they will also see. Thank you, Lord, for my ears, which have been given to me by God. Ears that hear the roaring rain from the sheds, the melody of the winds in the branches of the willow, and the tears that weep in the eyes of the whole world. Ears that listen to the music of the people who come down from the hills into the town square to sing. The melody of the immortals, when we hear it once and never forget. To be able to listen to the melodic songs, melancholic voices of the cowboys, and the pain that groans and suffers in the heart of the whole world because of my faculty of hearing. Let me pray for the deaf. I know that after this pain, in your kingdom of love, they will also hear. Thank you, Lord, for my voice, but the voice that sings, that declaims, that teaches, that evangelizes, that enlightens, for the voice that plays a song and that his name speaks with deep emotion before such beautiful melody. I want to ask for all those who suffer from the inability to speak, those who do not sing at night, those who do not speak during the day. I pray for them, for I know that after this trial, they will speak again in the new life. Thank you, Lord, for my hands, but also for the hands that sow, that work, that harvest. The hands of love, hands of tenderness, hands that release men from the bitterness, hands that shake hands, hands of charity and solidarity, hands that attend to the old age, hands that write letters of love that diminish the pain. For those hands that cradle the son of another person's body as if it were their own in their bosom. And for my feet that lead me to walk without complaining. Thank you, Lord, because I can walk before my perfect body. I want to praise you because there are on earth unhappy, handicapped, amputated, paralyzed that cannot move. I pray for them. I know that after this atonement, in the other reincarnation, they will also dance. Thank you very much, finally, for my home. It's good to have a home. It doesn't matter if that home is a mansion or a slum, a place of pain, a nest, a bungalow, a house along the way, whatever it may be, but as long as in it the figure of love is not lacking, love of mother or father, wife or husband, friend, son or brother, someone to give us the hand, even if it's the gaze of a dog, because it's very sad to live alone. But if I have no one to love me, not even a roof to shelter me, not a bed to rest, I will not complain, nor will I regret, because I have you. Then I will say, thank you, Lord, because I was born. Thank you, Lord, because I believe in you, for your love, for my life. Thank you, Lord. May we be the creatures that are thankful to God for the opportunity of life. For your attention, thank you very much.